And joining us now with more on the coronavirus, we have established our Crescent City connection with our chief medical editor, Dr. Corey Hebert, who is in New Orleans. Dr. Hebert, hello, how are you? And we heard from the surgeon. Ooh. I know, it's wild. We heard from the Surgeon General today. Now the whole social distancing thing is 10 people at a time in a gathering. Places are closing down left and right. Where do we stand today?
All right, so I really want people to understand why we're doing this. And we're not just doing it because we don't want to be close to people, because we do. The problem is that we talk about we want to flatten the curve. So let's understand what flatten the curve is. I'm going to take you back all the way to like high school algebra. You had a graph, and that graph, one graph, the line would go straight up and come straight down. And then the other graph would go straight across. Now, the area under the curve that goes straight up and down, let's just say 150,000 people get exposed. That means 150,000 go, it get exposed, and then 150,000 people will be sick at the same time. That would overburden the medical establishment. So when we flatten the curve, that flat curve is still 150,000 people that get sick, but you get 10,000 people over a 15-day period. You understand what I'm saying? So with a sharp curve, 150,000 at one time overburdens the system. 10,000 people 15 days at a time, over 15 days, then that means that you will have 10,000 people at a doctor, at a hospital, which is not going to overburden the system. So that's what we're trying to do, because when you have a bunch of people at a big event, they're all going to get sick at the same time and overburden the system. So we want people to not be around each other at big events, so the systems maintains at a constant level as opposed to overburdening. Does that make sense to everybody? Because that's a really important concept.
It does, doctor. But let me ask you this, too. We're talking about just the coronavirus, but we have to remember that there are people that just are sick, period. People in the ER that have heart attacks or whatever the problem may happen to be. And now you're piling that on in addition. Is there any way that the system can handle all that?
You know, honestly, right now we're hoping that we have capacity and people start to self-quarantine and social distance, and it would look a lot better. I want to give you just some numbers here from China, because I don't know if you guys have ever been to China. I've been to China many times, and they have 1.5 billion people in China, okay? They had their first case, and I'm looking at this data, on November 17th. That was their first case. By December 31st, 2019, they had 381 cases. They have 3,000 deaths now, but they shut everything down January 23rd, which meant that they had one case November. They didn't shut everything down until January 23rd, but they shut everything down so strong, they only have 3,000 deaths, which means, and they have 1.5 billion people, and they're stacked very tight in Wuhan and in Beijing and Nanjing. So what I'm saying to you is we have much more spread out areas. We have only 320 million people. So if we do our social distancing and shut everything down appropriately, we should have less than 3,000 deaths. And 3,000 deaths seems like a lot, but when you think about the flu, it's gonna kill 40,000 people this year. It's not as bad statistically, obviously we don't want anybody to die. But in the way when we deal with public health, we have to think about this in a global way, because we know that people are going to die. It's just gonna generally be people that are very much older, and that's why we're trying to protect it. We don't want anybody to die. And if we do this right, we can make these numbers very low, but you have to do it right. And you have to know that why we're doing this is because we are trying to protect the people that are at most risk. And those are our elderly people that have gone through their lives and they're living their twilight. And we want them not to have to deal with this. And you know, what we found also is we looked at the symptoms. The symptoms now are just runny nose, cough, congestion, fever can be any virus. But what this virus is showing, the COVID-19 is showing, is that it is a harsh, harsh, dry cough with a fever with an abrupt onset. So you're not gonna be feeling kind of weird and achy for about 3 days, then this happens. That's not how it's presenting. It is, this morning you okay, this afternoon you feel like I got a cough real, there's a lot of harsh, dry coughing, and a fever of anything over 100.4. That's what we're seeing. And what we've also found is that the people that are asymptomatic, meaning that they don't have any symptoms at all, which is gonna be at least 50% of the people that get exposed. They may have a positive test, but they have no symptoms. Even the people that don't have a positive test, they are the ones that are actually spreading the virus more. There's more of a concentration when they sneeze than for people that actually even have the disease and have symptoms. So that's why we want people to not gather, because you think you're fine, you're 35 years old, just bouncing around the city. You are the one that actually is spreading it in a higher concentration.
My goodness, that is quite a lot of detail there. Thank you. We have a much better perspective. Thank you so much, Dr. Corey Hebert.
Absolutely.
Have a good night.
We're going to get through this.
We sure will.
Absolutely. All right, now.
All right.